information on the use the live stream page too. Hello, everybody. Welcome to a Hyperledger Foundation webinar with Post Italiane. I'd like to welcome you all here. If you're watching this on Zoom or on YouTube or on the recording, glad you're interested in this topic. I'd like to introduce Emiliano and Rosario, who will be sharing about their experience using Hyperledger. With that, let me just go through a couple quick housekeeping items. Hyperledger is an open community, and so that means everybody is welcome. So thank you for joining. If you're interested in what's going on with Hyperledger or with the blockchain space, we're glad that you're here and are exploring more about what's going on with the community. Just one quick note, we operate under an antitrust policy, which means that all of the activities are in accordance with applicable antitrust and competition laws. If you want to learn more, there's a link here. The session is being recorded and it will be available both on the website, the Hyperledger website, and on YouTube. And we'll also make the slides available. And then lastly, if you are interested in asking questions or having a discussion, feel free to use the raise hand feature in Zoom. You can also use the Q&A feature, or you can use the Zoom chat. There's also a chat on the YouTube page. If you're watching the live stream there, you're welcome to ask questions there as well. So with that, why don't I hand it off to our guest speakers.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, wherever you are in this moment. Before starting, let me briefly introduce myself. My name is Emiliano Rennini. At Poste, I am the head of the ICT innovation strategy. I've been working for Poste Italiane over the last 14 years, dealing with innovation projects. During the last 4 years, I have been working with blockchain technology. Together with me today, also Rosario. Please, Rosario. Okay, sorry, Rosario, I can see you, I can hear you, so please make a...
Yeah, I'm not hearing you either, Rosario.
Sorry. I messed it up. It's just my first webinar, you know. Once again, good afternoon. My name is Rosario Chiara. I'm serving as a system architect, a technology lead on this specific project. Emiliano is on the strategic side. I put my hands in the guts of the systems. This is my main task. Okay, please.
Yeah, so let's start. Let's start about Poste Italiane. As you can imagine from the name, Poste Italiane is a postal provider, a logistic company, but it's not just a logistic company. Poste Italiane is a multi-business company. It's also a bank, is the biggest electronic money platform in Italy, is the biggest proximity network in Italy with over 12,000 postal offices spread all over the Italy. Read on this slide some numbers related to Poste Italiane, and so we have about 35 million customers, 1.5 million people that every day visit our postal offices. So you can imagine how big is Poste Italiane. That is without doubt the biggest company in Italy. We are also the main digital identity provider in Italy. We are supporting actively the digitalization of public administration in Italy. SPID, that is the Italian solution recognized by the Italian government, has right now about 26 million users that use the this digital identity solution to gain access to online services from public administration. And Poste Italiane released about the 85% of the total identity, digital identity in Italy. And so you can imagine that for that reason, we are really interested also in the evolution of digital identity. And so we are studying, we are trying to figure out what could be the future of digital identity, the new evolution model of digital identity. And that is the reason why we started about 2 years ago our project related to self-sovereign identity. Just to set a common ground, a common knowledge, I assume that you probably know what is self-sovereign identity, but again, in order to set a common knowledge, I will start describing what is the evolution of digital identity over time. And so probably the first model is the centralized identity model, in which government or private actors manage the identity of the users in order to give them access to its services. And so there are single operator that holds all the information about the users. And you know that probably the main problem related to this model is the fragmentation of the user identity, because users need to have multiple accounts in order, one with every service that the user want to use. Also, there's a third party that can track all the online user interaction. The federated model partially fixes some of the issues related to centralized model, and there are a bunch of identity provider that work together in order to have just one identifier for every citizen. And so the users, the citizens, can have access to online services just using one username and password for a different set of online services. This model solves the problem related to the fragmentation of digital identities, but still there's a third party that can track all the interaction and and can manage all the data related to the user. Self-sovereign identity is try to solve also this issue. And the main goal of the self-sovereign identity model is to bring the users back at the center of the model and allow him to have the direct control over his data. So in the self-sovereign identity model, the data are in the unique control and possession of the users, who is able to define and to decide to share it on a case by case with the service provider. So it's totally different from what from the models that we are experiencing right now. Imagine probably you use Facebook Connect in order to gain access to a different website. You use the Google authentication. So there's in this model there's a one provider that could be Google or could be Facebook, who manage your data, who share your data with third parties, and can track all your online interaction. Self-sovereign identity try to fix this, giving the let me say, giving the full power to the user. It's not a new topic. It's something that has been created or in some way defined almost 10 years, over 10 years ago, by Christopher Allen, who was the first person to define the 10 principles of self-sovereign identity. But now this model is gaining popularity thanks to the evolution in technology, but also thanks to the concern also about the regulators and the governments about the privacy of the users and of the citizen. So as I just said, why it is the right moment for self-sovereign identity? Because I can describe you what is happening right now in Europe. There's a really big concern about the privacy of the users. Last June, the president of the European Commission introduced the possibility to develop a European identity wallet that can be in full control of the users and is unique for all the European citizens. So a model that could go over and in some way also unify all the different experiences in the member states of the European community. And it's the right moment also because with the Green Pass in Europe, probably we have the first try to go towards a self-sovereign identity model, because you know that the Green Pass is in possession of the user, is the user that can share directly to gain access to physical place all over the Europe, okay? But you know that there are some problems, some issues with Green Pass. Last month, have been released Green Pass for Mickey Mouse or for Napoleon, and there's no way to invalidate this pass because they were generated using valid keys. And so the unique way is to invalidate all the certificates that have been released using that keys. So it is the right moment to work on and to build a different digital identity model, a different digital identity system. Just to give you an example, this is what happens daily in our daily life, no? And this is something that all of you probably have experienced. If I need a certification from a public authorities, from a public agency, what I need to do is to go to the public agency, identify myself, and then the registry office will release an identification document that I can store in my wallet and I can share directly to third parties in order to use one service or to gain access to a place or whatever I need to do. This document have a specific format that is recognized by third parties, is certified by the issuer using a special sign or something like this, but In my daily life, I have direct interaction with issuer and with verifier. Okay. SSI try to replicate that model also in the digital space. Okay, so again, also in the online in the digital space, so what I need to do is to identify myself to a public issuer, to a trusted issuer, in order to collect what we usually call verifiable credential, that is a collection of a claim about myself from an attester, from the issuer. Then I can store the verifiable credential in a safe place in my wallet, and then I can use that verifiable credential wherever I need to have access to, and to prove my identity and to prove the claims related to my identity to a service provider. Of course, in order to prove the authenticity and the validity of the verifiable credential of the claim, we can use blockchain technology, because every credential, once it is released, is anchored to the blockchain. Not the full credential, of course, but an hash, something related to the credential, is stored on the blockchain. And so one of the main goal of the self-sovereign identity is trying to replicate what happens daily in physical world, also in the online space, in order to give full control to the user over its data, and do not rely on third parties to be authenticated. So let me introduce what I call the building blocks of the self-sovereign identity. For sure, probably the main components together with verifiable credential is the DID. DID stands for decentralized identifier. Decentralized identifier is a unique and persistent identifier of the users that is anchored to the blockchain. This identifier has some characteristic. For sure, is decentralized, and so there's no need for central authority to generate it. It's persistent. There's no need to change it over time. It's resolvable, meaning that it is linked to metadata about the subject. And last but not least, is also cryptographically verifiable, meaning that the subject can prove the ownership over the identifier using public key cryptography. On the right of the slide of this chart, you can see the typical reference model for a DID. The DID is controlled by a subject, by an entity, and identifies is referred to a DID subject. Every DID resolves to a DID document. A DID document is a digital document, usually in JSON format, that describes the subject identified by the DID. It usually contains the DID itself, a verification key that a third party can use to prove the ownership over the DID, contains the authentication method used by the DID controller and the DID subject of the DID, and a service endpoint in order to contact the owner of the decentralized identifier. Usually DID is just a string. You can see here a format of the DID. IBSI is what is usually called the DID method, and this is a specification of the DID. Bezu can, in this case, identify a network, and then there's a string. In this case, you can what we use, but Rosario will share later with you more details. What we use is the address of the smart contract identity proxy that is related to the user, to the DID, to the identity of the user. Another main component of the DID ecosystem, of the DID model, are verifiable credentials. Verifiable credentials represent statements or claims made by an issuer and refer to a subject. These claims are generated in a way that make them tamper evident and privacy preserving. You can see verifiable credential as the equivalent of the identity document in the digital space. And this is a definition from the V3C specs about the verifiable credential. They contain information to refer the verifiable credential to the user, usually a DID. They contain information about the issuer who issue the verifiable credential. Also, the type of credential. For example, if it is a passport, a driving license, a health insurance, whatever you want, contains also specific attributes about the subject. For example, in the case of passport, the nationality, the validity, and information related to constraints about the verifiable credential, expiration date, term of use, and other things. All information that you can find today also on a physic identity document. And last but not least, another main component of the SSI model is a wallet. That is an application in full control of the user, whose functionality are keys and DID generation. So through the application, you can generate your cryptographic key used to manage your identity and also the decentralized identifier. The wallet is also used to collect verifiable credentials all in one place. It's under the full control of the user and is also being used to share credential with third parties in order to have access to online, but also physical services in place. What is the main flow and the life cycle, let me say, of a verifiable credential? At the center, as I said before, there's the users who request data claims from a trusted issuer. Sharing with the trusted issuer the DID in order to refer the verifiable credential to the DID. The issuer sends attested data directly and so sends a verifiable credential directly to the user, but anchor the credential to the blockchain. The user can collect the verifiable credential in his own wallet, and then can share this verifiable credential to other parties, to a service provider, in order to to have access to these services. For example, is to rent a car or to book an hotel, or the application or the services in which today you need to identify yourself or to attest something about yourself. This is the main flow of the digital creation. Now let me say that let me ask you if you have some question about what we have discussed so far, if you are working on the same topic, what is your point of view about this topic? Does someone have some question? Okay. We will have also...
You have been exceptionally clear, Emiliano. Okay, there's a question.
Oh,
which did the issuer in the previous slide?
Oh, as I said before, the DID stands for decentralized identifier. So you don't need someone else to issue DID for yourself. You can generate DID by yourself. As we will see shortly, in our case, we generate a DID and release the DID to the user. But this is what happened in our scenario.
And Alex, I see that you have a question too. If you want to come off mute, you're welcome to ask it.
Okay, this is a quite common question. What made you choose Hyperledger Besu for this project, and which other protocols did you evaluate before choosing?
Yeah, it's something that I'm going to share with you, but I will reply to your question. We use Hyperledger Besu because it has some feature that are good for our scenario, namely on-chain permissioning. Is an Ethereum client, so it is ready to be fully interoperable also with the Ethereum mainnet. But we mainly choose Ethereum also because, as I said before, we are a multi-business company, and digital identity is just one of the things on the topic that we cover in our activity. And Hyperledger Besu gives us the flexibility to have different use cases, different application, all in the same over the same infrastructure. We evaluated also Hyperledger Indy, but Hyperledger Indy is very specific for digital identity, and we prefer to use something that we can use in different scenarios.
There is another question. I'm interested in understand the time that takes verification process. I may try to answer this one. The verification process is a process divided in two phases. There is a presentation request where somebody will ask for a specific kind set of credentials. For instance, to buy the ticket, this is the scenario we will show later on. To buy the ticket for a concert, you have to present two different credentials, one that certify your identity, and the other one that will certify you have been vaccinated. This presentation request is the first step, And the second step is the presentation, the actual presentation that will constitute of the fact in the fact that the wallet app in the hand of the citizen will send assigned presentation that is just an object containing the two credentials that were asked for. Both these events, both these operations are tracked down on the blockchain, so are a real writing operation on the blockchain that will last for the time, at most for the time of a closing block. So it depends on the actual blockchain you have underneath on and how it is really configured. This answer, I hope this is the answer. So in the current version we are using, we have a closing time, a closing block time about 10 seconds, I guess.
Six seconds.
Okay. There is also, you have two operations that summed up are at most 12 seconds. There is another question that asks if it is viable to verify billions of users at a time. This is the verification process is once again a presentation and request and present a proper presentation loop. And once again, you need to scale your infrastructure in order to accommodate such a number of request per seconds easily. The good thing of blockchain is that you may be able to scale up these quite easily. Of course, in a system like our, not just everybody can install a validator node, but it is something viable in a way. And The short answer is that we are not really aiming at this goal at the moment. We are most in the phase of developing a proof of value more than a proper production ready system.
If I can add something to what Rosario just said, the sharing of credential almost happens off chain, okay. So you don't need to write on the blockchain every time you share a credential with a third party. The third party just have to read on the blockchain to check the validity of the credential. And it is a really good point because we all know that right now blockchains have some limit in writing something on the blockchain. While is it good at reading operation? So we think that the system could scale. I don't know if to support billions of transactions or user, but for sure, what we have the chance to test is that it can support over 1,000 reading operation per second right now.
There is another question. Let me check. Okay, I lost the chat. Okay. This one says, what is the governance framework for digital identity in Italy? Is there a minister for it?
Yeah, for sure. There's a minister, and there is also a public agency who define the technical specs for a system to be compliant with the national identity framework. Right now, SSI is not part of this technical identity, this technical framework, but we are working also with public agencies in order to develop the framework in order to include also SSI within the recognized digital identity scheme in Italy. But again, we are also working with European Commission.
Okay, there is another question. What's the roadmap for the wallet? Which credentials are you planning to add? Will it include the financial services? The roadmap is something we described in the last slides, I guess. And the credentials are not predefined. I mean, the system is can accommodate whatever kind of credentials you would like to use.
Again, sorry, this is right now, this is a prototype, this is a experimentation that you are running together with other public agency in Italy, okay? So we don't have a defined roadmap of adoption of such a system. Probably we'll need to wait for a regulation, and then we can define a specific roadmap. And yeah, it could be for sure a good idea to add also support for financial services in our wallet. You know that, as I said before, that Poste Italiane is also a bank, is also a payment service provider, and so we can combine together identity with financial services. And for that reason, we are also interested in what's happening globally with the central bank digital currencies.
Okay, there is another question that I'll try to summarize is, how the ecosystem can trust the DIDs going around? I may answer to this one. DIDs are just what the name says, are just an identifier. What you have to actually trust is the credential and the presentations that will be the real where the real meat of the system is. And this is performed, and I will try to discuss this in the next few slides, in registries where these credential representation hashes are kept track of. So the DID is not really the problem. Actually, you can create as many as DID you want. DID is just an anonymous identifier you use within the system. So you don't have really to trust the DID, but you have to trust what a DID does in the system.
Okay. If there are not other questions, I will go on. Okay, just two slides, then I will leave the stage to Rosario to go deep in technical details of our solution. As I said before, self-sovereign identity is not a new topic. There are a lot of projects running about self-sovereign identity, Sovereign, UPort, ION, Alastria, and in order to not reinvent the wheel, we decided to start from the Alastria implementation and to customize it based on our specific needs. Why Alastria? Why Alastria? Because Alastria share quite the same vision about us, because the as Alastria is a stable and mature technology, and as just said before, because Alastria is built on top, Alastria ID is built on top of the Alastria blockchain. We use Hyperledger Bezu and Hyperledger Fabric. So for that reason, we decided to start from the Alastria implementation and from the Alastria ID model. Okay. Now I leave the stage to Rosario, who can share with you technical details about our solution.
Thank you, Emiliano. Next slide. Okay, this is something Emiliano already has described before. What we liked is to develop a system that can be compared to current to system already available around. So we took a clear decision here. We developed our system PostAID like Alastria, like Alastria did, likewise Uport Certo did. So it is just based on smart contracts on a generic Ethereum virtual machine. In our specific case of use, it is Besu, as said. We liked this solution because it allows us, please next slide, allows us to accommodate more than one use case on the same blockchain. So PostID in our specific ecosystem will be just one of the use cases, and as the intent of become the standard identification layer among these use cases. Next slide. From a technological point of view, of course, you have to have this kind of diagram in a slide, a diagram with the staked blocks. On the left, you can see the current version of the system. So you have a PostID wallet, which is a mobile app that will use PostID wallet API, and together with the example issuer and the example the service provider, which is just the verifier for credential, both three these three different identities will interact with the PostID library that is a thin layer of JavaScript that will play together with the smart contracts that are hosted on the node. We are moving toward a more generalized version of the same architecture where PostID, the wallet app, the issuer, the verifier will just be a special flavor, a particular flavor of an extremely configurable agent called PostID agent that will interact with smart contracts and with will allow to have a highly configurable infrastructure that can scale and accommodate different use cases. Okay, next slide. This is the agent-based situation. The agent-based scenario is what we are working on right in these days. So we are pretty confident to have something running in this new way for the end of the year. Talking about deadlines. Okay, next slide. From a logic point of view of the smart contracts we collect on the blockchain, we have in these slides altogether a group photo of the different smart contracts. We, as Emiliano said, we have designed our solution starting from what the colleagues of Alastria already made. They took a decision, and we liked it, and we kept pushing on this decision. What we did is to have a solution registry-based. So in the blockchain, you will have a registry collecting all the identities, that is, everybody will interact on with the system. Whether it is a citizen or an institution or a website selling concert tickets. Then we have a service provider that will collect the particular situation of entities which will provide the services. So they are interested in verifying credentials. Then we have the issuer registry that will collect the particular entities that will provide credentials. And then we have the credential registry, presentation registry that will collect the hashes, so just the track of credentials, the issued credentials, and how they are used within a presentation. That are the two sides of the triangle Emiliano showed before. Then we have a public key registry Then we have a public key registry that let us to connect an Ethereum public key with the DID in a proper way. And this also allows us to implement a recovering mechanism. In the case of the most common case where a person loses his phone or just forget the his phone somewhere and they get lost, he will be able to install another app, generate a new wallet, and ask a couple of friends, named the Guardians, to associate his new phone with the new public key to his previous DID. In this way, he will be able to access once again to his previous identity. Then we have another registry, the credential schema registry, that will collect the different schema of credentials you will be able to get, to receive, to have issued, and to present in a presentation. At the core of all the system, there is the identity proxy. The identity proxy is a special and extremely simple smart contract that is deployed once for each DID. So the DID provider will just deploy a smart contract, and smart contract, this such a smart contract just separates the interaction that will happen on your wallet toward the actual operation you perform on the registry. The address of the identity proxy is what will constitute the DID part, the proper DID of our system. Okay, next slide. Okay, so this is the life cycle we depicted before. So we have as Emiliano said, we are just Poste Italiane, and we are one of the I don't know, Emiliano, maybe this one is something you will present, or I will keep going. Okay. Okay, so we are Poste Italiane, so we are digital identities the largest digital identities provider in Italy. So in our specific version of the wallet, you will be suggested to ask for the issuance of the first digital of the first credential of your digital identity that can be the SPID credential. SPID is our digital identity, national digital identity system. This is not at all mandatory. Actually, we also have a white label version of the app where this is just a configurable step that you can easily skip. Then you may ask for a vaccination credential, and once you have collected both these credentials on your wallet, you will be able to buy a ticket on a website. In the video, in the next slide, you will be able to see how the interaction with the SPID provider, the vaccination center, and the website may happen in different ways, both with deep linking and with and by the means of a more traditional QR code. Okay, next slide. Okay, this is we of course we made a video because to run away from the wicked witch of the demo. Okay, this is the welcome screen. This will ask to unlock the storage. We intend to use hardware storage to memorize the private key. This is the most common phase of generation of our wallet. So we'll just have to wait some second. Okay, this is the wallet has been generated. This is the passphrase. Okay. And this is the home page. Of course, in the banner, in the upper part of the screen, just invites the user to receive the speed credential, the speed credentials from Poste Italiane. Let's go with the video. Okay, now. Okay, this is my DID, QR code in case you intend to share it. Vuoi andare un po' più avanti, così andiamo direttamente alla generazione di speed. Okay, this is the moment where you perform a legacy authentication on speed. This is not the generation of a speed identity. You already have a speed identity with the Poste Italiane from your previous life. And this moment, in this moment, you are doing a legacy authentication on speed. Then go on. Okay, this is the legacy authentication with the PIN. Okay, this is the moment where you have received, you have translated your previous speed credential in a new SSI-based credential. And you just have received it. This is just the list of the events that happen within the app. Okay, let's go on. This is the application. Let's move a little farther. Vai avanti ancora perché qua è lunga. No. Col video, sorry, I just switched to Italian because my Italian is way better than my English. Okay, this is the moment where we are asking for vaccination credentials. The QR code is just may I pause. The QR code is just the presentation request. The website of the vaccination center is just asking us for a digital identification credential. So they are asking for the particular, the specific credential schema that is SPID. This dialog just requests the user to authorize the sending of the credential. Fingerprint to unlock the hardware encrypted storage. Okay, we signed the transaction and we send the credential to we send the credential to the vaccination center. It has sent us back the vaccination credential. Okay, now we have both credential. The SPID credential for our identity and the vaccination certificate for the vaccination. And we will be able to buy the ticket for the Deep Purple concert. Okay, next, go faster here because it is pretty, okay, these are just the data. Okay, now we are on the website where you can buy the ticket. This is the presentation request. They are, in this particular presentation request, the website is asking us for two credentials, as said, the identification and the vaccination. We are, in the particular case, we may have, for instance, more vaccination credentials in general. In case you have more credentials that are there, to a particular credential schema, it will be allowed, the user will be asked to select one single credential to send back to the verifier. Okay, next. Okay, now the system will just accept the presentation. The back office of the system may check if the signature is correct, if the schema is correct, and so on. Okay, and as you can see, the web page has accepted the credential and has unlocked the button to finalize the buying of the ticket. Okay. As you, I don't know if it was clear among the different things we showed, there is a place where you can see the different credential you have in your wallet, and you can see, or you can also see the life cycle of such credentials, right? That is where such credentials have been actually presented. From such dialog windows, you will be able to control the presentation, and for instance, to revoke a presentation from a verifier. Okay. This is the roadmap. We are hammering our MVP3 for hopefully for December 2021. These are the specific functionalities we are working on. The social recovery functionality that will allow us to recover the access to a lost identity. Selective disclosure, this is a tough one because the idea is to allow the citizen not to release the whole credential, but just the single bit of information in a safe and secure way to access a particular service. The most classical example of zero knowledge proof is to provide the in a secure way the fact that you are older than 18 years without saying your birth date. And also, the current version we are working on is, as I said, the architectural evolution moving from the library-based version to the agent-based version. This is some quite deep architectural effects that would be nice to discuss with a beer, and that's all. Okay. I don't know if there are more questions. Okay, please, Emilia.
Yeah. I don't know if you have any question about the second part of the presentation. We are here to try to answer you.
There is an old question about why we used Ethereum and not instead of a more modern blockchain 3.0 platforms. Federica Trill is telling us about Java-based platform. Actually, this is a project we started a couple of years ago, and the Ethereum-based solution as the most promising for us, and also maybe it was the only available at the moment. This is something we must keep an eye on, of course. Thank you for the idea.
There is also another question from Simone, who asked what are the security mechanisms in order to avoid that a subject A can generate a DID for a subject B and start to run online interaction on behalf of subject B. As Rosario said, DID are pseudonyms, okay? So are not direct tied to an identity. What is tied to an identity are verifiable credentials. Verifiable credential contains claims about the a subject that is a DID, and so you have information about the subject of the DID inside the verifiable credential, who again is subject is assigned by a trusted issuer after an online identification of the subject. In the scenario of the demo, what you have seen is that I have generated my DID as the first step on the app, but I have no credential related to such a DID. What I do is to have a legacy authentication using the classical speed, and then Poste Italiane acts like a trusted issuer and release you a verifiable credential containing the same information, the same claims of the speed identity. Okay, but I need to perform before the legacy authentication with speed, with two-factor authentication, with the same level of assurance of the actual speed authentication. And I don't know if it may clear the scenario. There's another one question from Matteo. How the service provider verifiable will request to Poste a select part of verifiable credential? First of all, to make clear, the service provider will not ask to Poste Italiane to release a presentation and to share a credential. Always, the service provider verifiable will ask directly to the user. There's always a direct interaction between the user and the issuer, and between the user and the service provider. So the service provider, the verifier, will ask to the user to provide an information. For example, in order to buy a beer or to buy a drink, you need to prove that you are over 18. And so this is a piece of information that the verifier will ask. Show me that you are over 18. Okay, and it is contained in the presentation request. The app will recognize the request and will ask to the user to provide such an information. So it's all managed by the agent component.
Okay. There is another question for you, Emiliano.
What would be a viable business model?
Yeah.
that's a really good question. Because we are, as you can imagine, we are wondering what could be the business model. And what we think is that, yes, digital identity will stay free for the citizen. And will be always free in order to be more inclusive. But what we think and that we can provide what we call premium services to help the users manage their identity. Let me make you an example. The decentralized models is what you have, for example, for Bitcoin or for crypto or for decentralized finance. Give full control to the users, okay? But from what, as I said, as I usually say, from great control become great responsibility. So probably not all the users are ready to manage their keys or to store the verifiable credential in a safe place. What we think is that we can provide premium services in order to assist them, giving, for example, an encrypted backup, or to assist them in case they lost their phone or they have compromised their keys. This is what we are... what we think could be a feasible business model. I don't know if it's clear, Simone.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. The last question is about, it's quite clear to me that by means of verifiable credential issued directly from Poste, after a legacy authentication based on speed, Poste can issue a verifiable credential including all the same data that is already included in the speed electronic identity.
Yeah. Okay.
Correct. Okay.
But the last question is what about the trustworthy of the private key generating by the wallet itself? I mean, when I set up the wallet, I'm going to generate a set of key pair. For simplicity, let's think one
key pair. Private and public key. Okay.
One key pair. Okay. One key pair, yeah.
Okay. Who is the issuer that among all the ecosystem can assure the trustworthy of that key pair? Because in the end, the key pair is generated by a personal handset. I mean, so an app running on that handset, okay. But the key pair, or better saying, the hash of the key pair will go into the blockchain. But who is the subject that can guarantee for that key pair? For sure, cannot be the end user itself.
Okay. No, I mean, just to be clear, the hash of the key pair doesn't go on the blockchain. The key pair, the private key, is just stored on the wallet of the user. Okay, it's only stored in the wallet of the user. Okay, there are no hashes of private keys that go on the blockchain. First of all, just to make clear.
No, I've cut short. I'm referring to some derivative data. Nothing relating to the private key itself. I'm referring to the public key for sure. And I cut short for speed up the questions, but I'm referring actually to the fact that something, some reference needed to be stored about the public key inside the blockchain. And I think in my knowledge about the deed document, it's not the deed, the deed document.
Yeah.
So there is something that the deed document is a signed object.
Not really.
Yes. Okay.
No, I mean there is could just be a public key.
But it also it can also contain a proof.
Exactly, that is a
proof of possession over the DAD documents and could be signed by the owner of the DAD. Okay, and so it can contain proof, so a sign from the owner or the private key, and of course a verify key that is the public key in order to check for the authenticity of the DID document.
Okay, it's clear.
Okay. Any other question?
People are welcome to ask any other questions. We have the room if we need it, but if not, thank you everybody for joining. Maybe we can give one or two more minutes to see if anybody else has a question. I'll also share my screen.
Okay.
Just to encourage everybody, you know, this is just one way to get involved with the Hyperledger community. If you're interested in this discussion and want to continue the discussion around decentralized identity or about blockchain in general or about any of the Hyperledger projects, you know, you are welcome to get involved. If you have questions about how to do that, you're welcome to email info@hyperledger.org. You can also go to our website, hyperledger.org. There's a number of different resources there around how to get involved in the community, how to learn more about the different projects, all of our tools as an open source project, all of our tools are also open as well. You're welcome to get involved on our chat, on our wiki, in our repos, on our mailing list. So we do hope to see you again after this webinar. And this is just one of many webinars we host. If you're interested in watching more, keep an eye out on our website. We also host a number of other virtual meetups, other community calls. You know, there's a lot going on in the community. If you are interested in getting involved more, we would certainly like to see you again. And again, if you do have questions, certainly feel free to reach out. And with that, thank you for joining. And we appreciate your time today, and we hope you learned a lot. So thank you very much.
Bye, Charles. Bye,
everyone. Thank you. Bye-bye. Have a nice day.
You too. Bye.